down here with you.
Okay.
One of the scriptures, the first scripture, is from Genesis, the 28th chapter, the 16th verse. When Jacob awoke from his sleep, he thought, "Surely the Lord is in this place, and I was not aware of it. How awesome is this place? This is none other than the house of God. This is the gate of heaven." By the way, the last time I spoke to you was 6 years ago. We were in another place. I'm very impressed with what you've done here. This is really nice. And then the next scripture is in Matthew. I think I lost my marker, but I know the scripture. It's the very last verse in Matthew when Jesus says, "And lo, I am with you always to the end of the age." 6 years ago was very memorable for me. I can't describe it to you. It just touched me in places in my heart and mind, in places I've never been touched before. And you know, some other things came out of that that were nice to happen. I'm glad to be back with you, and I want to thank Rick for inviting me for this honor to be with you today. To recap, some of you may remember that the service was on, is it really remembrance, this thing we call communion? Or is it something else? And that was one of the things I wish Jesus hadn't said, not because I wish he hadn't said it, but the way we interpret it. It gets us off the hook, because all we have to do is just think about him and remember him. This is not a memorial service. This is not a Jesus step back in history, but it's a Jesus ripping 2,000 years to be here with us when we celebrate his presence. I think we tend to forget sometimes that when Jesus said, "Do this in remembrance of me," that was a Jew speaking. And he was speaking Aramaic, and the language was dynamic. So when he said remembrance, he's saying, make it happen again, or it will happen again. It's in a reenactment. It's not just something we leave back in time. I think the illustration I used that Sunday was a group of us men would go up to our house in Lake Junaluska, and we would have a good time. We would play some golf. We'd get a little irreverent at times. But the peak of our experience was profoundly reverent. We would get in our cars and we would drive over the Cataloochee Trail, which was set, by the way, by Francis Asbury 2 centuries ago. And we would go up the mountain and down the mountain into that valley to a little church, white clapboard church. It makes me think of the church in the Wildwood. You know that song. It had a belfry, and there was a bell that still rang. The floors creaked. The benches had no cushions. We took our wine, and we took our unleavened bread, and we had communion service. I remember one time we took Bob Wright's golf shoes and put them beside us. If you'd been a fly on the wall, as I mentioned 6 years ago, you may have seen some shoulders trembling and some hands shaking and a tear or two fall. But we weren't thinking about Christ. We were feeling his presence. And that's what this is all about. What I'd like to do today is to try and take that concept to the next level. And if you would, pray with me and for me. Oh God, may the words of my mouth, the meditations of our hearts, be acceptable in your sight and part of your vision for us. In the strong name of the Trinity. Amen. Some of you in sophomore lit, I think it was in college, that I had to read a poem by Walter de la Mare. He was a novelist, a writer, an English writer from the mid-1800s into the early 1900s. And he wrote a poem called The Listeners. Any of y'all remember that? The Listeners. "Is anybody there?" said the traveler, knocking on the moonlit door. and his horse champed the grasses of the forest ferny floor, and a bird flew up out of the turret above the traveler's head, and he smote upon the door a second time. "Is anybody there?" he said. But no head leaned over from the leaf-fringed sill to look into his eyes, where he stood perplexed and still. Folks, the basic question of philosophy is, why is there something rather than nothing? The basic question of religion is anybody there? And the two are inextricably linked and intertwined, because if you ask one, you ask the other. If you answer one, you answer the other. The question has been asked down through the ages, and there have been variable and varied responses. I remember an experience I had when I was above the Arctic Circle. I was a chaplain above the Arctic Circle for a year. And don't ask me how that happened, it's too long a story. But I remember one night I was eating dinner with an Eskimo family. This was at Barter Island. Barter Island is just right on the boundary between Canada and the U.S. Prudhoe Bay was just getting cranked up then. So it was a pretty lonely, empty place. And Sammy Neotok was my friend who invited me to dinner. And he said, "Have you ever ridden in a dog sled?" I said, "No." Nope. He had a snowmobile. He said, "Would you like to ride back to, like me to take you back to the site in the dog sled?" And I said, "I'd love that. That'd be nice." So he went out and harnessed up the dog and everything. And we're going out across the tundra, and it is just a bright sky. Every star is out. And the aurora borealis, that curtain of color, was just dancing above me. And I was standing on this sled, and I reached over and tapped Sammy. I said, "Can we stop?" He said, "Sure." So we stopped for a minute. I have never felt so insignificant looking up at that vast sky, seeing that cosmic color dance back and forth. And I questioned my faith. Is anybody there? This is a big world, a big universe. Is anybody there? Several months later, by the way, the view line, there were radar sites every 100 miles. This was put in place in the Eisenhower administration to protect us from Russians coming over the top of the world to attack us. And I was at Pin 3, which was in Canada, and it was a very isolated place. There were only 6 people on the site. We were running out of the supply planes couldn't get in because the weather was so bad. We were running out of food. To get our water, we had to take chainsaws and go out to a creek and cut out blocks of ice and bring them in and melt them. I mean, it was getting a little bit desperate. Well, there was a library at every site, and that was my salvation. So I went to the library, and I found Admiral Richard E. Byrd's book, Alone, one of his experiences on Antarctica. And I was reading through there, and there was a segment that captured my attention. It was about how he got caught in a whiteout. Now, folks, a whiteout is when the moisture crystallizes in the air, and grown folks are just on their hands and knees looking for a doorknob that might be inches away. They lose all concept of distance, of direction, east, west, north, or south, up and down, sideways. It's gone. And he said his first reaction was one of total fear. And some time went by, and he said the second reaction was one of anger. He wanted to strike out, or whatever it was, because he didn't understand it. That hadn't been in his reading material. Time went by, and he said he had a third feeling. And the third feeling was that of a presence. I think about the whiteouts of our lives. I think about parents who know their children are in school and believe they're safe there. I think of people who know their loved ones on Sunday morning are in church in the sanctuary. and they feel they're safe. And then the horrific news comes that they've been gunned down by a mad, attention-seeking person. Our fears, our anger, is anybody there? Tens of thousands are being slaughtered in Syria. The fear, the anger, is anybody there? We have violence in our streets. Domestic terrorism in the land. Our fears, our anger, is anybody there? I think about a 60-year-old man who's been told he's got 7 weeks to live. I can't imagine his fear, or perhaps his anger, and him asking, is anybody there? Children watching their parents throw verbal bombs at each other. I can only imagine their fear and perhaps their anger. And I wonder, is anybody there for them? All the lonely people, where do they all come from? That's a line in a song. Anybody remember that song? Eleanor Rigby?
You bet.
In the mid-1960s, the Beatles wrote it and sung it. It's about a young lady, Eleanor Rigby, who sits and looks out a window and sees people passing by, but no one will come near. Across town, Father McKenzie's writing a sermon that no one will hear. No one comes near. All the lonely people, where do they all come from? Is anybody there? I would say that most of us, if not all of us in this room, have asked that question ourselves. Is anybody there? You know, we're in some pretty good company. Moses asked that question. Moses was in a frustrating situation. He got upset and he said, Lord, I want you to show me your glory. I got to be sure about this. And God says, Moses, I'll put you in a cleft of the rock and I'll put my hand over you and I will pass by and remove my hand and you will see my back. But no person will see my face. You know, I bet Moses sitting on Mount Nebo, and some of us have been there. He had the Holy Land, the land of milk and honey, a panorama before him. He could see the Mount of Temptation, the Mount of Transfiguration, and Mount Zion on his horizon. But he couldn't go over there, and I bet he wondered, you know, what's happening here? I'm the one that brought you here. Jacob, when he was going from Beersheba to Haran, the part of the scripture I read, he, is that an amen, John Wesley? he was a man with a broken heart. I don't know what was going on with him. Maybe he'd gone bankrupt. Maybe he was having all kinds of interpersonal conflicts, intrapersonal conflicts. I don't know, but he was a very upset person and a very lonely person. And he laid down that night in a place and had a rock for his pillow. And that's when he saw the ladder. And when he got up the next morning, what did he say? Surely the Lord was in this place, and I didn't know. The psalmist asked that question, is anybody there? Well, in different words, the psalmist said, Lord, how can we sing your song in a strange land? How long will we have to hang up our harps on the willows of Babylon? Would you believe it? Jesus asked that question. He's on the cross. He says, my God, why have you forsaken me? Is anybody there? The disciples asked that question. They're trapped between Good Friday and Easter. I cannot think of a more desolate, depressing place to be than between Good Friday and Easter. Your best friend gone, your dreams dashed, your hopes in ashes. And something happened. Now, y'all, I can't describe the resurrection. I can't give you any details. There are conflicting reports about it in the scriptures. There are even scriptures that say people who saw the resurrected Christ didn't believe. So I defer to a young boy whose mother took him to see the Grand Canyon. And as the story is told, he gets out of the car and he runs on ahead of her to the observation deck and he looks out and she's approaching him and he looks back at her and he says, "Mommy, something big happened here." Well, we do know some things about the resurrected Christ. Scripture tells us that each time the disciples witnessed his presence, they were having a meal. Check it out. We know that his presence was comforting. Whether it was a meal beside the Sea of Galilee on the shore there, it was an upper room in Jerusalem, we know that it was convicting. We know that it was energizing. We know it was motivating, and we know that presence was loving. We know the fire still burns. The flame still flares. The heart of our faith still beats. The love still flows. "Mommy, something big happened here." Well, let's bring it home. Scripture tells us that Jesus was met by a woman of Samaria, in Samaria, and she asked him which temple she should worship. Should she worship the temple in Samaria? They had one there. Or should she worship the temple in Jerusalem? Listen up. Jesus tells her, he said, "Woman, the day is coming when both of those temples will be destroyed. And you will worship the Lord in spirit and in truth." Let's bring it a little closer home. Everyone in this room knows that on April the 28th of 2014, this temple was destroyed. Or was it? Is anybody there?
Christ our Lord invites to this his table all who